Penguin Random House Audio presents Into the Black Nowhere by Meg Gardiner. Read for you by Hilary Huber. We serial killers are your sons. We are your husbands. We are everywhere. Ted Bundy. Chapter 1. The cry pierced the walls, ringing through the darkness. Shayna Kerber roused and squinted at the clock. 12:45 a.m. Her voice came as a sigh. Already. Shayna huddled for a minute under the comforter, clinging wishfully to warmth and sleep. Hush yourself, J.D. Please. But the baby's crying intensified. It was her strong, wide-awake, I'm hungry cry. The night was bitter. Early February, the north wind scouring Texas. It whistled through the cracks in the farmhouse, rattling the doors in their frames. Shayna rolled over. The other side of the bed was cool. Brandon wasn't home yet. For a few more seconds, Shayna lay still, aching with fatigue, hoping J.D. would quiet. But she was crying to beat the band. 10 months old, and still up twice a night. Shayna's mom swore things would get easier. She'd been swearing so for months. When, Mom? Please, when? Coming, baby, Shayna murmured. She tossed back the covers, brushed her sleep-tangled hair from her face, and slogged out of the bedroom. The hardwood floor creaked beneath her bare feet. JD's cries grew clearer. 6 feet down the hall, she slowed. The crying wasn't coming from the nursery. The house was completely dark. J.D. was too little to climb out of her crib. Shayna turned on the hall light. The nursery door was open. A sliver of ice seemed to slide through her chest. At the far end of the hall, she could see into the living room. On the sofa, half lit by the hall light, a stranger sat, holding her little girl on his lap. The icy sliver sank through Shayna. What are you doing here? Don't worry. I'm a friend of your husband. The man's face was in shadow. His voice was soothing, almost warm. She was crying. Didn't want to wake you. He seemed completely relaxed. Shayna walked slowly to the living room. She glanced out the front window. The moon was full. An SUV was parked outside. A placard hung from the rearview mirror. Is that... She looked him up and down. Army? Are you? The baby twisted in the man's arms. He bounced her. She's quite the little doll. He tickled J.D. and made baby talk. Shayna tried harder to see his face. His eyes remained in shadow. Something stopped her from turning on the table lamp. Is he a friend of Brandon's? Shayna extended her hands. I'll take her. The wind battered the windows. The man's smile persisted. Though she couldn't see his eyes, Shayna had a gut certainty that he was watching her. She edged forward. She was 8 feet from him, out of his reach. Give J.D. to me. He didn't. Her hands were open. Please. J.D. twisted in the man's arms. Her chubby legs pumped like pistons. Shayna's heart thundered. She saw the power in the man's hands and knew she couldn't simply charge at him. The shotgun was under her bed. 5 seconds was what it would take to run to the bedroom, grab it, and rush back down the hall. It was a 12-gauge. It was loaded. And it was useless, because this man was holding her child to his chest. Her breathing caught, like a cloth snagging on a nail. She inched forward. Give her here. For a few seconds, he continued bouncing J.D. Crying, the little girl reached starfish fingers toward Shayna. She wants her mama, the man said. Aw, come here. Shayna held still, her own arms outstretched. Give me my baby. The smile stiffened. the man set JD gently beside him on the sofa. Before Shayna could inhale, he lowered his shoulders, gathering himself. He was in motion when the light finally hit his eyes. The dashboard clock read 1:30 a.m. when Brandon Kerber turned onto the gravel driveway. The truck bounced over the ruts, stereo blasting Chris Stapleton. Brandon whistled along. His rare Saturday night out had been golden, a Spurs game in San Antonio with friends from his army days. He curved past the stand of cedars, and the house came into view. What? The front door was open. Brandon gunned the F-150 up to the house. The windows reflected the truck's headlights like wild eyes. He jumped out. In the wind, the door was banging back against the wall. An acid taste burned his throat. Banging that loud should have woken Shayna up. Inside the darkened house, he heard a mournful sound. Crying. Brandon rushed in. The living room was cold. The headlights threw his shadow ahead of him on the floor like a blade. The crying kept up. It was the baby. JD lay huddled on the floor. He scooped her up. Shayna? He hit a light switch. The living room lit up, neat, clean, and empty. JD's eyes were red-rimmed. She was exhausted from sobbing. He pulled her to his chest. Her cries diminished to pathetic hiccups. Shayna! Brandon ran to the bedroom with the baby and flipped on the light. He spun and strode down the hall, looking in the nursery, in the kitchen, the garage, the back porch. Nothing. Shayna was gone. He stood in the living room, clutching JD, telling himself, "She's here. I just can't see her." But the truth closed in on him. Shayna had vanished. She was the fifth. Chapter 2. Early morning shadows slashed the road. The sun blazed gold through the pines. Caitlin Hendrix accelerated and swung her Highlander into the grounds of the FBI Academy in Quantico. Beneath her black winter coat, her credentials were clipped to the left side of her belt. Her Glock 19M was holstered on the right. The text on her phone read Solace, Texas. Caitlin got out, and the freezing wind lifted her auburn hair off her shoulders. The Virginia winter constantly reminded her she was an outsider here. She liked it that way. It kept her on her toes. She buzzed through the door and headed for the behavioral analysis unit. Suspected serial abductions, the text read. The people Caitlin passed walked faster than the detectives she'd worked with back at the Alameda Sheriff's Office. They turned corners more crisply. She missed her Bay Area colleagues, missed their pride and camaraderie. But she loved seeing FBI on her creds, with the words Special Agent beneath her name. Phones rang. Beyond the windows, the blue glass walls of the FBI laboratory complex reflected the rising sun. Caitlin approached her desk in BAU 4, where she was currently one of 8 agents and analysts assigned to crimes against adults. She said good morning to her colleagues as they arrived. Everyone had received the same text. The Behavioral Analysis Unit was a department of the FBI's National Center for the Analysis of Violent Crime, a branch of the Critical Incident Response Group. Its mission involved investigating unusual or repetitive violent crimes. Critical incident response meant that when a hot case came to the BAU, it acted, and fast, because time was limited and people were in danger. Like today. She barely had time to take off her coat before an office door opened at the far end of the room. "Don't get comfortable." People looked over. Special Agent in charge, C.J. Emmerich, strode toward them. 5 women have disappeared from Gideon County, Texas, in the last 6 months. The latest was 2 nights ago, he said. The victims have all vanished on a Saturday night, and the period between abductions is diminishing. Emmerich's gaze swept the room and landed on Caitlin. Escalation, she said. His nod was brief. Commonalities between the abductions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.